So, hi everybody, welcome back to our C++ programming course. Today we are going to talk about error handling and the various ways you can handle errors in C++. And at the very end we will briefly talk about one other type of pointer, namely function pointers and what you can do with them. But maybe let's just start with error handling and then we'll come to those nice looking function pointers later on. All right, so error handling. How to handle program errors? And that's unfortunately a question which I can't answer for you. That really depends on your concrete problem that you wish to solve in a given programming language. And this not only holds for C++, but in any programming language, really. Usually you work in a specific domain and you have to solve a specific task in that very domain. And sometimes you can encounter program errors. There are various reasons for that and you have to handle them somehow. But unfortunately, I can't tell you how to handle those errors because, again, that depends on your domain and your concrete problem. But what I will tell you, at least in this lecture, is what kind of techniques you can use. And then you kind of have a toolbox, and then you can, depending on your problem, you can then look into that toolbox and use what is appropriate for that task, really. So more important is maybe what will be answered in this lecture, how to detect, recognize, and then finally handle errors, right? So that is what we're going to talk about today. And there are, in fact, three or four, depending on what you count, important mechanisms for that. First of all, the most easiest thing to implement, of course, is ignore the errors. And of course, do not ignore errors. I mean, that's even bad in your toy example programs that you implement here for this course. But in production, I mean, if you write production code that should run on some machinery or whatnot, you won't be able to just ignore errors, right? I mean, you can do that, but you only do it once, and then you are typically fired and maybe also sued. So that is not a good idea. So in fact, there are only three important mechanisms. And those are return codes. So you can use return codes to indicate a certain error situation, which you can then check and handle appropriate. There are assertions, static and dynamic assertions that you can use to kind of detect and spot errors and anomalies. And those are typically used to handle or detect your own errors. And then as the ultimate thing, to handle errors, there are exceptions, and I will tell you all about those three thingies, about all those three tools here. And really, error handling is very important. I already mentioned that if you implement some production software, you need to handle errors, right? So you can't just assume, okay, here my function gets a pointer as an input parameter. Yeah, I just assume that it can never be null because then I don't have to check. But I guarantee you there are situations that you did not think of in production, and at some point you will get the null pointer as an input and then your program typically breaks. Just one example here. So that's a very important part. And it can also be fun if you got the hang of it, really. So maybe let's start off with an example and see how we could handle errors. And let's have a look at our nice scalar product function. Like in one of those last lectures, we implemented the scalar product function, which, yeah, computes the scalar product of two vectors. And we had some situation which was tricky because we could not handle that yet, but hopefully after this lecture we will able to do that. And that is if those two vectors are of different length, then we basically have a problem. So here's our signature, right? Our scalar product function takes two const references to vectors to double, and it returns a double, which then comprises the scalar product, right? So, and the, again, I already mentioned that. What if U and V do not have the same length? Then computing the scalar product does not make any sense, because in mathematics, it's just not defined that way, right? And now imagine you're a math library implementer, for instance, who charges really a lot of money. So I already showed you in the very first lecture, there's quite a lot of money in C++ software development. And so, but you also have to do a good job then. That's for sure, of course. And your customers, of course, to which you wish to sell your math library, they wish to have code that works reliably. And they also want to know when something goes wrong, rather than just getting nonsense results, or wrong results even. That's even worse. So users of your library would like to know about an error or a misuse of the scalar product function. And first of all, why could that even happen? So how come that the vectors are of different length? I mean, we are all smart typically, right? Otherwise we wouldn't like develop software at all. But how come that this can happen? First of all, it could be that the user has no clue about mathematics. That could be one reason, which is the probability of that is not very high, but can happen. User has made a typo. Maybe he wanted to actually hand in as an input parameter to that function a different vector, but he accidentally misspelled the variable's name, for instance. A user could have created the vectors dynamically and then something went wrong there for whatever reason. Typically, it's also that you read oftentimes data from files, from your file system. And it could just be that the file that you read from contains some invalid data or ill-formatted data, and then you end up having two vectors of not the same length, which is what you don't wish to do. And there are, of course, millions of other reasons that you can come up with. And there are really lots of sources for errors, because we are all humans at the end of the day. And software development in general, I mean, it requires quite an amount of concentration. And I'm, for instance, an early person, right? I can think in the morning when my brain is fresh. And then if I have to write some code in the late afternoon or even in the evening, yeah, I wouldn't count on that. I do make mistakes. So then the question is, why does our world not crash if it's easy to introduce mistakes? First of all, of course, our world heavily depends on critical software systems. So nuclear power plants, for instance, run on software. So in our modern world, basically everything runs on software. Planes, for instance. So how can you safely board a plane and then don't be afraid that your plane crashes? And yeah, after Airbus's last incident, or several incidents even, tricky to answer. Then credit institutes. Right, if you use online banking and if you make a transfer from some of your money to, I don't know, some bank account of your friend or some other guy or whatnot, and someone accidentally or on purpose switches off your Wi-Fi router, you wish to make that this money is either transferred or it still resides on your own bank account, but you don't wish your money to be lost, right? And so important things and challenges to keep in mind. Cars, of course, I mean, modern cars heavily run on software as well, especially the autonomous ones like Tesla and also modern BMWs and whatnot, you name it, like all the major car companies. Trains, for instance, you don't want two trains crashing into each other. And one other question maybe, does your grandma use software? And you might, no, she doesn't have a smartphone, but yeah, but at the grocery store, if you use the cash registers transitively, right, then they run on software, really. And so when critical software fails, either people get injured or people get financially ruined. So that's a very good definition, I would say, of critical software. So when that kind of software fails, you can have either of those two things, and you don't want to have either of them. It's both terrible. So, but how can you board an airplane without fear then? And I mean, for the last years, that was quite a good question. They could answer, yeah, you don't need to be afraid to board a plane, but like the last incidents I mentioned on the previous slides, troublesome. But usually such systems are heavily restricted and standardized, so you cannot just write some arbitrary code that then runs such critical systems and operates, I don't know, critical machinery or whatnot. So first of all, you have to deal with restrictions and standardizations, which is a good thing, I guess. So for instance, for airplanes, so there's no new, no delete after takeoff. And same holds for malloc and free, of course. In cars, no dynamic memory allocation at all, because the chance to introduce mistakes is just too large. So it's typically, those are two examples of restrictions for the airplane and car industry, basically. Then, of course, use error handling. That is what we will cover today. Also use excessive testing. I already mentioned that a few times by now. So if you implement a certain functionality, you don't just think that you're smart and then my implementation doesn't contain any errors, so it will run fine, sure. No, that's not how you do it. Typically, how you do it in most cases is you use test-driven development. So you write some tests, and ideally first, before you implement your functionalities, and then you implement your functionalities, and then you run your tests, and also add more and more test cases to make sure that you pinpoint the function to what it should do, to what it should be in terms of behavior. There are also methods for formal verification and also static and dynamic code analysis. I myself, for instance, I do static analysis. I'm a static analysis researcher, for the most parts at least. And also as examples for dynamic analysis, remember that we talked about the Valgrind memory analysis tool, and we also used Clang sanitizers, which are also a kind of dynamic analysis. So the compiler instruments your code and it will detect memory issues like accesses to memory that do not belong to your program, or also I showed you in the last exercise class, the undefined behavior sanitizer, which comes in quite handy to make sure your program is all right. And our research group focuses on secure software engineering. I already said it, I myself work on static code analysis. And especially in the world of C++, which is a statically compiled language, we will have a dedicated lecture on static analysis, because it's, I would say, really important for your general understanding of C++. And it also allows you to develop a much kind of deeper feeling or deeper understanding of how your compiler actually works, especially how compiler optimizations work. So we will have a dedicated lecture on static analysis later on that helps you to become a better programmer and write code that the compiler can optimize well. There's also a thing like people try to prove software, but that's typically impossible for like the software as a whole, because many problems in static analysis and also verification and proving of software, many problems are undecidable, so there can't be an automated solution in form of an algorithm. So many undecidable problems, so we have to kind of find our way around to kind of over approximate or under approximate. Oftentimes that's better than knowing nothing about your software. And at least you can sometimes prove parts of your software. It's sometimes possible within a certain scope, so you can prove that an algorithm, for instance, provides the correct results, at least for some. And in order to, go into that proving software approach here, like some credit institutes, for instance, use languages such as Haskell, which is a functional language. And in a functional language, you, I don't know if you know functional languages or you know what that is, probably many of you do. So that is, you only implement functions in terms of recursion, really. Is that fair to say? I don't know. But then you have that kind of perfect composition, and then you can test individual components. And if you can be sure that the individual components produce correct results, then you can be certain that their composition also produces correct results. So, I mean, it has quite some cool properties, which is why it is used by some like finance institutes and whatnot. And also, as a sixth thingy here, a bullet point, of course, get the best people for the job, right? So if you need to implement critical software, get the best people that you can find. For instance, Bjarne Straustrup, the creator and father, so to say, of C++, is, for instance, managing director for technology at Morgan Stanley, which is a US finance institute. So those are the things you can use to counteract critical software failing. So method one, let's be more concrete. Let's use return codes and see how that goes. So the basic idea really is to use a cleverly designed return code to report a problem. That was our scalar product function, right? And we had this problem here when the size of U and V are not equal, if they don't have the same length, so to speak. And what we could do is we could return nan, which is not a number. That's a special floating point value that indicates not a number, which kind of indicates that an error occurred during computation. It's kind of a very special value here, which you can also check for. And so if the vector lengths do not match up, we return not a number as a special value. And otherwise, we just perform the computation and return the result. And a caller of that scalar product function might check then the result for not a number. So for instance, what would be a scenario here would be you have two vectors, A and B, and to trigger that kind of error here, we just let them have a different length. And we call our scalar product function, store the result here in that result variable, and then we can use the function std isNan and check if that result is not a number. And then we know that at least something ran wrong in that function. Otherwise, if it contains a number other than not a number, a value other than that special not a number value, then success, we apparently computed kind of the correct result. That is good as a first starting point, but there can be multiple reasons why that could be not a number. I will come to that later on one of the next slides. Okay, so, and there's not only not a number, really, there are some more special floating point numbers or floating point values which are kind of reserved. So when working with floating point types, not a number is quite common, and also what is important to notice is that not a number propagates through calculations. So if you have some computations that involve double, variables of type double, or any values of floating point type, really, and one of those values is not a number, then the result of that whole computation on the right hand side, that whole expression will evaluate to not a number. So at the very end, value will also be of value, not a number, really. So it indicates, that is hopefully clear by the name, indicates that the value is not a number. There's also infinity, So positive in infinity as a special floating point value, which is kind of a special reserved value. So, and you can get positive infinity if you divide by zero, for instance. And so that would also answer the question, what should that value of something divided by zero be? In computer science, it's infinity, positive infinity. There's also negative infinity. So if you divide something by zero and you negate whatever is the result of that, so you get negative infinity. That's also a special value that exists. And yeah, it represents negative infinity. So there are also useful functions to check those kind of special values, which are included in CMath. So if you wish to use them, just include CMath, and then you can use the functions. We already saw that one on the last slide, is not a number, is finite, is infinite, is normal, would be kind of it's an ordinary floating point value, none of those special values. And for more details, please have a look at cppreference.com and look up the header file CMath to see what's available and also to kind of get the documentation for that. So there are some more special numbers that you can make good use of typically in your implementations. And so on the last slide, we saw special numbers for floating point types, and there are also kind of special numbers for integer types. And you can get the information by using numeric limits. So there's a special type numeric limit, which you can find in the limit setter file, which you can basically ask for some special values. For instance, let's have an example. So you can ask the minimum value that you can store in an ordinary integer. How can you ask that? So what you do is, there's a special type here in the header file limits, which goes by the name of numeric limits. And that is a type which you give a type that you wish to get information on. So if you want to know something about integer, so just give it int as a template parameter, and then you can call a function. So min, apparently, I never looked it up really, but apparently, according to the syntax at least, it must be a static member function of that numeric limits type for the specialization integer. If you don't know what that is, leave it be. We will discuss the details about that later on. Anyways, so you give it your types that you're interested in, and then you can, for instance, call some function on it to get information. And here the minimum function gives you the minimal integer that you can store in the data type int. Isn't that great? Because that's oftentimes useful for certain computations. You can also get the maximum value, of course, like that is the maximum value that you can store in data type int. You can also get the min and max for the unsigned integer data type, like give it unsigned and it will tell you. You can also, like for floating point numbers, get the epsilon, which is kind of the space between two numbers. I mean, I already also mentioned that in the very first lecture, because of the finite representation in memory, you can't have like infinite precision floating point numbers. That's just impossible. And for that reason, you can have two double values, but you have there's some space in between which cannot be represented in your computer. And like the epsilon, if I recall correctly, gives you the, like, how large is the space in between? So what kind of value range is in between, which can't be really represented in your computer, in your machine. And if you compile and execute that code, it will give you like the following answers. And those can come in quite handy if you need to check certain things. So let's say you wish to perform a special computation, and then first of all you wish to check if your ordinary integer data type on that machine is large enough to perform a certain computation. Let's say you have an algorithm which requires very large numbers, so it could be that integer, the entire data type int, might not be like big enough or large enough to fit in the values that you wish to compute with. And you can use those numbers or special values here to figure some such things out, really. And yeah, sorry, I forgot to remove that using namespace std, so I'm not a fan of that, so just ignore that line and remove it. And here we also have a special value that I wanted to talk about to you, because I mean, sometimes it's a bit useful and sometimes it's a bit nice to read. So if you use your character output stream variable cout and you print something to the command line here, for instance, you can also set certain flags here. Here, if I recall correctly, that was a decimal flag, so like the scientific notation. And whenever you set that flag, which you do by the following, you just name that flag and also kind of use the left shift operator to put it into the output stream, so to say. And if you then give it a number, it will print that number in scientific notation. There are also some other flags which you can use, for instance, I have to look them up, and you probably also need to look them up. There are some other flags, like for instance for bool, and then if you print a bool or something that can be converted to a bool, instead of the value, for instance 0 or 1, it would then really print true or false as kind of strings to the command line. So sometimes it's nice to know, I guess. Okay, so let's continue maybe on using return codes. So return codes in general are a common value to report success or failure, and the C programming language makes heavy use of it, because there are not much other ways in the C programming language of kind of report errors or handle errors. There is that set jump long jump feature in C, and I only tell you that once here, and I don't care to explain what that is. I leave it be. No, okay, I won't explain. So functions that return an error code are then, of course, you need to know what the error code means, right? Typically, you return an integer, and then that integer can have, I mean, of course, several values, and all those values have a certain meaning. And typically, if you use error codes to report an error in a function, you document that function, for instance, with source code comments, with an error code table that tell users of that function what each error code means, right? So for instance, your function could return the integer value 0 to report success. And it could, for instance, return the value 1 if it, I don't know, could not open a file, for instance. It could report number 2 or value 2, integer value 2. If a function could not establish a socket, for instance, or whatnot. So typically you would also document it with an error code table that documents how to read. And then you can check, of course, using an if, what that return value is, if it is an error code or if it's just a success, and then you can handle according to the type of error that you found, basically. And return codes are also quite common in C++ too, so many C++ projects also use return codes. That was not always the case. So and also it depends on the project, as I just mentioned. So some projects do not use exceptions at all because of the kind of performance penalty sometimes. So you give the compiler a harder time when you use exceptions sometimes. Other times it's a hard topic. Maybe I'll leave it be. As far as I know, Google's internal C++ coding guidelines also recommend return codes to be used to report errors. But I don't know if that's still the case or might have already changed. I don't know. And also, please keep in mind that sometimes return codes are not very intuitive, like in the scalar product function. In the scalar product function, we currently naively handle the error and check if the vectors are of different length. And if so, we just return not a number. And then the user could check for that. But the user then knows at the very end that the result is not a number, but he does not know the origin of that kind of not a number. I mean, it could be that both vectors have been of different length, but it could also be that one of the vector's entries just has been not a number for some reason. And I already mentioned that not a number propagates through computations. So it's enough if one of those vectors' entries is not a number to make the overall results overall result not a number as well. So that way was not very meaningful. And now you can come up with the idea to change the signature to the following. So let's have a scalar product function which receives one vector and another vector and provides the result as an output parameter here using a reference and return an integer to kind of describe the error that happened, if any, or otherwise success, obviously. But I mean, that's really a terrible style, I feel like. I mean, we have functions for a reason, right? Functions get some inputs and produce some output, just like in a mathematical sense. So, and then using the output for some error and returning the result as an output parameter, I don't know. You can find such things in practice, but I'm really not a huge fan of that. Make up your mind about it yourself. I feel like that's not a smart thing to do, at least. So what would maybe be a smarter way of doing that would be using C++ 17 std optional. So std optional is a special data type that is implemented in the STL. So if you wish to use it, just include optional, the optional header file. And so how you can change your implementation then is you have your scalar product function. It receives two const reference to vectors of integers. In our case, oh, sorry, that should be double really here. That is my mistake, sorry. Should be all double. And as a result type, it returns an optional double. And just by the name optional, you maybe already have a good idea what's going on here. So the idea is that the return value is optional and that the return value exists if everything worked fine. And you also can have an empty optional, so then you don't have anything as a result because something went wrong, and you can check for that. You can check for that. And that way you also don't have to misuse not a number for reporting such an error. So let's have a look, how would that work? So first of all, again, we would check if the sizes of u and v are not equal. And then we could return std null opt, which is basically the empty optional, which does not contain a value. So that would be our error case here. And in the ordinary case, we just perform the computation and return the final result. And that code works perfectly fine. And then a user can write the following code. So he or she calls the scalar product function, and the result is a std optional of double stored in the variable r. And you can ask, r has value. So is there a value? Is the optional not empty, so to say? Do I have a real value? And then you can get the value by calling the member function value to access the value. Here would be a different example where the vectors are of different length, right? So vector A has a length 3. This temporary vector that we put in here has only length 2. So that thing would print false because it has not a value. So the null opt will be returned and you can check for that. So, and this comes in quite handy really oftentimes. All right, that should be it on return codes. Then we have a different thing that we can talk about. We can talk about assertions, which are also quite nice to use. And typically you can, of course, find bugs with assertions. So you can assert something, some kind of property that should hold. And if the assertion fails, and if that thing that you just assumed that you asserted does not hold, you get an error. That is quite useful. You can check if a certain condition holds, and if not, a hard error is reported, typically in form of a program crash. But I will tell you why that is okay using assertions. So we have, for one, we have that dynamic assert, which is evaluated at compile. Exactly the other way around. So we have that dynamic assert, which is evaluated at runtime. Okay, so while you run your program, then the assertion is checked, and if the assertion fails, kind of, then the program just crashes. And you know that you have a bug in your software. And that can be, that's a cool thing here, that can be switched on or off. And that's also why a program crash in this situation is not that bad. It's, I mean, a program crash is hard to be ignored, so that's a good thing. And the idea behind that dynamic assertion is as follows. The idea is that you develop your software product by using assertions. And you check if your property is sold and if everything is fine. And if not, of course, the program crashes, and then you fix those issues with your program. And once you are pretty confident that your program works fine and everything is good, at some point, of course, you wish to ship your software product to your customer. And you will then wish to send him an invoice and charge a lot of money. And before you ship your software product to a customer, you compile it with the dynamic assertions switched off, right? That's a basic idea. So for development, you use dynamic assertions, and if you're fine, if you're confident that the program is correct, for the most parts at least, then you switch them off and ship your software product to the customer. And that mechanism uses the preprocessor symbol no debug, ndebug. And if that symbol is defined, you basically switch those dynamic assertions off. And if that symbol is not defined, then those dynamic assertions are on by default. And of course, it's dynamic. It is executed at runtime. Those checks are executed at runtime. So it affects runtime performance. I just mentioned that already. So here would be an example. In order to use assertions, you would include C assert. And depending if you wish to switch those assertions on or off, you would then comment in or uncomment that line here that defines the preprocess symbol no debug, ndebug. And you could write a piece of software which just comprises a small main method. And here you assert something, and here you assert something which is obviously wrong. Like 2 plus 2 should be 5, that is what you assert. But you can compile your program, and your program will compile fine. And if you run your program will crash. And it will tell you, yeah, the assertion failed here, 2 plus 2 is not equal to 5, actually. How is assert implemented? Maybe just for the insiders, if that is interesting to you. So it's like preprocessor magic. We will also have a dedicated lecture on the preprocessor sometime later on. But here you basically check if the symbol no debug is defined. If it is defined, so you wish to disable the assert, to make it go away, basically. That is here kind of saying, yeah, just don't do anything. And otherwise, you have your assert here with a certain condition, and then here you would have your actual implementation, which would then check if that condition is true. And if it is false, the assertion does not hold, and then your program would crash. And here you may wonder, is it possible to kind of append an error message as well, because here it only takes one kind of condition that it evaluates. And the idea is, yeah, can I maybe append a string or something to get a bit more information when something goes wrong? And yes, you can, by using a strange trick, because you can check your assertion here, same as on the left hand side, so you still have your assertion, and you just use the logical AND. This is the logical AND, right? And then you use a string literal. And what is the idea behind that? Why does it work? That eventually produces one single condition which can be evaluated, and if it fails, even this message is reported to you as well. And the idea behind that is to use the logical AND, and that thing, that string literal on the right hand side, that of course has to live somewhere in your program. So somewhere in your program code, after you compiled it, you have that string, of course, stored somewhere in your program, probably in the data section or something. And of course that string has a memory address, right? It lives somewhere in memory, so it has an address, and that address is different from null. So that's basically just ordinary logic. So you use logical AND, and here on the right hand side you have something different from null, which in terms of C++ or C would be considered true. So that right hand side will always be true. So, and then the only thing that can make that false is the assertion of the left hand side. So that's one trick kind of to also append some additional information to a dynamic assert. Using assertions. You can also use static assertions, which are evaluated at compile time. And the good thing about compile time is it doesn't affect runtime. So if you can do a check at compile time, why not do it? Then you don't have to pay for it at runtime. And the cool thing about static assertions is you don't need to remove them when you ship your project, right? Because it's static. Once you compile your program, there are no runtime costs to pay. So typically static assertions you always leave in your program. And if a static assertion fails, since those are statically evaluated at compile time, the compiler aborts compilation and throws an error at you. So static assertions are really hard to ignore. I mean, you can't ignore, because the compiler will just stop compiling. It waits for you kind of to fix that static assertion that failed. How you could write it is a static assert, static underscore assert, then you, similarly to the dynamic assert, you give it a bool const express, or something that can be statically evaluated to true or false. It must be evaluatable, if that word exists, at compile time, of course, because it must be statically checked. And then you can also append a message, so that must be a string literal, a static string literal. And you can also leave that message, so you can also just use the version with only the bool const expression. And if bool const expression returns true, then this declaration has no effect, because, yeah, I mean, the assertion holds, everything is perfect. And if it evaluates to false, the compiler will throw an error at you, and you have to fix it. Message, I already mentioned that has to be a string literal. All right. So here would be an example. We have our static assert here, and we can just assert that 2 + 2 is equal to 5, which apparently is not the case. And if you try to compile that piece of code here, it will throw a compiler error at you. So this time that thing, that program will not even compile. And why does that work? Why can that be evaluated? Yeah, I mean, it's all static, right? So 2 + 2 here, those are all string literals. They're the bool expression here. Nothing depends on any runtime value whatsoever. So it can be evaluated at compile time, and the compiler is smart enough to figure out that this is not true. So dynamic versus static assertions, when to use what? Think about the following maybe. So errors are of course bad, so no one wants errors, everyone wants their software to function perfectly fine, of course. But if you do have errors and if you wish to detect them, probably the earlier you detect an error, the better it is, right? Because typically, if you already shipped your product to your customer and then you detect a critical error that has to be fixed, then it is really expensive to get the product back from the customer and fix it. I mean, for software, that's probably a bit easier still than if you, I don't know, sell TVs and then those physical TVs need some update. I mean, for software, you just send out another version to your customer, but still, it's bad enough. It's, of course, it's really expensive to detect errors in such late stages, as you can see for some aircraft manufacturers, right, from America. At least better than a late error. I mean, I guess we can all agree on that. So, and in C and C++, of course, it holds that everything that can be done at compile time should be done at compile time in order to kind of follow the spirit to generate really, really efficient code and have a very good performance. So discovering errors at early stages, of course, saves you typically time, money, nerves, and people in the worst case. So people, again, get injured or financially ruined if something goes wrong in critical software infrastructures. So, yeah. And now we talked about dynamic assertions. And if you know about dynamic assertions, which you now do, you can also think about contracts, functions, and invariants. And you can use dynamic assertions to enforce contracts and to enforce invariants and to make sure that those things hold. It's kind of a special view on programming. So let's see what that view on programming actually is. So functions can get some input. Functions typically get some input and do some useful work and produce a result, and that result is at the very end outputted as a result. And a function can be viewed as a contract. So there are some preconditions that must be met. For instance, the scalar product function would have as a precondition that both vectors u and v are of same length. That would be one precondition. Otherwise, the application of that actual scalar product algorithm does not even make sense, right? So that would be a precondition that you could check with a dynamic assert. So conditions that should hold before processing the inputs. And then you have some post conditions that should hold after the computation has been performed, that should typically hold for the result that has been produced. For instance, you could, as a postcondition in our scalar product function, you could assume or assert that the result is normal, is not a number. Exactly. And you can also use assertions, dynamic assertions, to ensure class and struct invariants. So what is an invariant? Invariant is if you call a member function and then that member function call leaves some state of your variable untouched, basically. So it's invariant to that function call, member function call, for instance. Let me give you an example here in a second, and that will become more clear. So, and if I already mentioned that, if conditions are violated, the application of the function rarely makes sense. But, yeah. So, function is or can be viewed as a contract, and the contracts can be enforced using dynamic assertions. And unfortunately, some conditions are really hard or even impossible to express. I unfortunately can't come up with a good example, but I guess it's not hard to believe that some conditions that you would like to check are really hard to express using assertions. And for those conditions, you can also, of course, use a comment, code comment in natural language then that the user of your function can read and can hopefully ensure. So please do comment your functions. So, and talking about invariants and talking about contracts, so how could that look like, for instance, for a class? Let's say you have a data type car, which is a class, and it should model, I don't know, model a car, a very simple version of a car, at least. So you give it a private data member, engine running, which is a bool, because the engine can either run or it can't, right? And that is here encoded using that bool data member. And then you give it public functions. You give it, for instance, a function is running, which tells you if the engine is running, and it just returns the underlying bool here, which tells you if the engine is running. And then you, for instance, wish to implement, say you wish to implement a function, a member function stop, which stops the engine. Then of course it only makes sense to stop the engine if the engine is already running, because if the engine is stopped, why should you stop it again? So it doesn't make sense. So, and the precondition here for that stop function would be that the engine is running, and you can enforce that by using assertions. You can have that as your precondition. So otherwise the application of stop engine wouldn't make sense. And after you stop the engine, you check if the post condition holds that the engine is now really stopped, which you use using a dynamic assertion as well. Otherwise, again, the application of that stop engine function does not make sense. And same for start. If your engine is, it only makes sense to start your engine if the engine is off. Otherwise, I don't know if you have already tried it. If you have a car, please don't do it. But if your car engine is already running and then you turn the key once again, that's pretty bad. I did it before, so. but it wasn't my car, so. So, you check if the engine is currently not running, and then you start the engine, and then you check that, and you assume or assert that the engine is running after that. So that's a very simple example, of course, but I hope you get the idea what's the view on that. All right, now let's talk about type traits, which have been introduced in C++ 11. And type traits give you information about types, which is really quite useful for many more, yeah, to be honest, for many more advanced applications. So for now, you probably don't need them, but later on in your career, that will be really interesting and quite practical. So type traits have been introduced in C++ 11. So let's have a look what type traits are. If you go on cppreference.com, it will tell you that type traits defines a compile time template-based interface to query or modify the properties of types. So you can get information on types themselves, which is an interesting thing, really. So if you wish to make use of type traits, just include that header file type traits. And type traits are often implemented as SFINE, which is a cruel acronym, which stands for substitution failure as not an error. I won't go into details about what that is right now. We will talk about that later on, maybe. Or yeah, probably. So type properties and different categories that you have primary type categories, you have composite type categories, you have type properties that you can check and kind of fiddle around with. You can ask kind of using type traits for supported program operations and supported operations on those type. And yeah, you can in general query properties of types and also check for type relationships. So later on, we will talk about one concept which is called inheritance. And in inheritance, you can have one data type that inherits from another data type. And using type traits, you can even check those inheritance structures. You can, for instance, ask, is my class or is my type Y a child of class X or type X, for instance. If you don't know what that is, doesn't matter. We will explain that later on in detail here. So here's an example using type traits. We have two types, struct A and class B. And in main, here is, by the way, a different flag, which is called bool alpha. And whenever something then is put in to see out, which is true or false, it will really print true or false instead of, for instance, a number or something. You can ask, is that A type, is that a class? And this would be the syntax. You basically use is class, give it as a template argument your type name A, and then colon colon access the value. Yeah, type traits are implemented using template metaprogramming. We will talk about that later. For now, it's just sufficient if you know how to write that, and it's perfectly fine. Looks a bit odd, but it does the correct thing, believe me. So, and is A a class? So that would return false, right? So this whole expression you would evaluate to false because A apparently is not a class, it's a struct, right? So, and you can also ask kind of, is a B, is the type name B, type B, is that a class? And this will evaluate to true because B is a class. You can also ask like is class and give it an int, which is obviously false, and also that will evaluate to false. Yeah. So that's just one small example on how you can use type traits. So with type traits, you can really use some type A, B, and int, or any type really, and ask about some properties using the type traits interface. Yeah. Sorry, that can be quite interesting here. And now we talked about return codes, we talked about assertions, and now let's talk about exceptions, which are basically like the holy grail of reporting and handling errors. Doesn't mean that's a good thing, but it's a very powerful tool at least, and sometimes that's exactly what you need to get the job done. So let's talk about exceptions to handle errors. But first of all, let me have a sip of water here. Okay. Let's go on cppreference.com and see what an exception really is. Or was it on Wikipedia? I'm not sure. I hopefully have it. I have my source here associated with that. So anyhow, exception handling provides a way of transferring control and information from some point in the execution of a program to a handler associated with a point previously passed by the execution. That sounds really promising, right? So you can transfer control and information from some point to some other point that you previously passed in the execution. Okay, let's see how it continues. In other words, exception handling transfers control up the call stack. And if you know how a call stack works, you know that up in the call stack means back in the past. So it's like in Back to the Future, but here it's a time machine back in the past, back to the past. So you can use exceptions in order to go back in time. Isn't that great? So it's like a little time machine in computer programming. So once you detected that once you detect an error and you figure out that you screwed up, then you can just say, okay, leave it be. I just want to jump back in time and avoid making that error, which is really, really cool, I would say. So a little time machine. And you really say, like literally, an exception can be thrown. That is the expression here. So an exception can be, you just throw it up the call stack, basically. And what can throw an exception? An exception can be thrown by a throw expression. So it's really a keyword, throw. We will have an example in a second. By a dynamic cast, by type ID, by new expression, You, for instance, can throw bad alloc if it can't allocate the amount of memory that you asked for. We discussed it in the last lecture. Any other allocation function as well. And any of the SDL functions specify to throw exceptions to signal a certain error condition. And yeah, I have that from CPP reference. Okay, cool. So interesting. So an exception can be thrown to indicate an error. And you really also say it like that, an exception can be caught. So you throw it up the call stack and you go back in time. And then at some point you need to throw it again and handle the error. In order for an exception to be caught, the throw expression has to be contained within a try block. So there's this special keyword try, which we will see in a second, which allows you to mark a certain block of code that is to be kind of tried out. And if something goes wrong, you can handle it accordingly. Or inside a function that is called in a try block, and the catch clause has to match the type of the exception. So apparently you can try something, and if what you wish to try throws an exception, you can catch it with help of the try block, and then you can have a catch clause where you handle the error appropriately. Okay, so that maybe sounds still somewhat abstract to you, but we will have first of all have a summary, but then we will also have a concrete example. So in summary, a certain type of an exception can be thrown to indicate an error, and an exception can be caught with a catch clause. And the control flow and also information is transferred to an earlier point at which the error can be handled. There are, however, some places where you should not throw. I have one or two slides. I don't know. I have some slides we'll discuss about in just a few minutes. There are some places where you should not throw, because otherwise you can get in really deep trouble. But I'll tell you about it. And this is necessary to guarantee resource safety. So let's have a very, very stupid example, but it shows the mechanism in general, and I hope you get the point then. So the situation is as follows. We have a vector v, which is initialized with three double values, 11, 12, 13. And then we have implemented something very useless, but again, to prove the point here, we have implemented a function get. And this function get gets a vector and gets an index. And the function get then returns the value that is at the index of that vector that you give it, and returns a reference to it. And then, for instance, we can print the reference. So, for instance, if we have our get method and call it with the vector v and the index 0, it would return a reference to that double 11, and we store it in that reference to a double variable value, and we can, for instance, here print it, and it will print 11. So far, so good. And how do we implement get? We implement get by just returning the vector at the index. And here we just use vectors squared brackets operator. So far, so good. I mean, that's not very useful, but at least it works. And here we get into trouble. So what if you have a naive user who doesn't know how to use that function, and a user of your function here just calls your get function with the vector variable v and asks for the index 100. But the index 100 does not exist. Because the vector only has three entries, right? So that's pretty bad. And in that case, you can throw an exception to go back in time. So here you check if the index is larger or equal to the vector's size, then this index does not exist in that vector, right? So here at this point we are in trouble, because we are asking for an index which the vector does not have a value for, so to say. And what we do is we throw an out of range exception. And this is how you write it. You really use the keyword throw, and then you give it an exception type. And here that exception, you can also give a string, which kind of here in our case gives some information on the error that occurred. So, okay, pretty bad, but we got away because we now throw an exception. So what happens now? What happens now? We dodged the bullet, basically. So what we now have to do is we need to put that code that may throws an exception like this one. We have to put it within a try block, right? We have to put it in a try block. And if that get function here now throws an exception, because in this situation it would do, certainly, then what would happen is we would clean up everything that happened here in the try block. So everything that happened in the try block would be kind of made undone. And we would then enter this catch block, which is also called the exception handler. Okay, so here we try something. If that thing throws an exception, like in this case it does, we go back in time, make all of that here undone, basically, and then we go to the respective exception handler, which is here indicated by the keyword catch. And here, what do we catch? What do we wish to catch? We wish to catch an out-of-range exception. And this out-of-range exception is exactly what we throw previously. And for that reason, that code will be executed. The corresponding exception handler here will be executed. And in this case, we just print error to the command line and also tell the reason for that exception. So the out of range exception transfers the control flow back to the caller's catch block. And the type of exception here must match. So the type of the exception stood out of range must match the exception that has been thrown. And the catch block is called the exception handler. Then you can handle the error accordingly. Here in our case, we don't do that, but in your programs, you would do. An exception is a class that contains all necessary information to perform the job, namely propagate an exception up the call stack. And among others, the header file std::except defines some useful exception types that you can use. You can have a std::logic logic error, invalid argument exception, domain error, length error, out of range error, runtime error, da 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 da. You can look it up in on CPP reference here, really. So, and you can also write your own exceptions as well. You would need to inherit from an exception class and adjust it to your needs. Maybe we are going to discuss that later on, but maybe not. That's not too relevant for most of the time. Okay. So, please don't use this one here. You can, I mean, main, of course, main is associated with the function body, right? Which is also a block. And so what you could also do is, like, this is meant to be a joke, right? But you could do it theoretically, but you shouldn't. You could also try main, so try everything in main. So, and whenever an exception is thrown of type runtime error, you just catch it here and just print to the command line. Something went wrong. That could also be done, but yeah, that's a joke. So in this case, please don't try your complete program and then do something. If it fails, please only handle appropriate situations, really. Okay. So how about our scalar product? How could that look like if we wish to use exceptions for that? What handling would be adequate? Return codes, assertions, exceptions. I don't know, you have to answer that for yourself, basically, and by looking at the domain you are working in. But if you wish to model the scalar product function with an exception, you could do something like that. You would ask and check if the length of the two vectors u and v are not equal. And in this case, you have that error situation. And here in this case, you could, for instance, throw a logic error stating wrong dimensions. Here a d is missing. And otherwise, you would compute the results and return it. And here would be an example. So in that example, you have two vectors of different length. And you try to compute the scalar product. And if it fails, you catch the logic error. And in this case, you just print an error message to the command line. But here, you would have the opportunity to handle that error appropriately. And please never catch like that. That can be seen quite a lot, for instance, in Java, but sometimes also in C++, an empty exception handler. So just ignore that exception and continue. I mean, that's not a very good thing to do, right? An exception usually tells you that something is exceptionally wrong. And so you better handle that and don't just ignore. But as those things here, empty exception handlers can be seen in the real world. Yeah. What is also possible is it is also possible to rethrow an exception. So, like, you could have the following. You can have your function call, which leads to an exception, and in your exception handler, you catch the logic error. And then you can do some work, for instance, if you would like to do that. And then you can rethrow that exception. You can rethrow that exception and continue propagating that logic error exception to an even to an even earlier point in the program. And then the exception would be propagated up the call stack. You'd undo everything that you already did. And the next exception handler of type logic error would take care of that. Okay? So the point is rethrowing is possible as well. So if you catch an exception, you can do some stuff, and then you can also rethrow that thing again to go even back, to go even further back in time until you have the next catch block that catches a logic error. If any. Hopefully there's some other exception handler for that kind of an exception. And what happens during a propagation of an exception? What is the mechanism of undoing things and going back in time? And that mechanism is called stack unwinding. So everything that did happen is kind of undone, and the stack is unwound. So stack unwinding is the keyword here, or not keyword, but it's a key phrase here. And there are even books and papers on that topic, so I won't go into too much details here, but I at least give you some rough idea, some rough understanding. For more details, please just go to cppreference.com. So, but the overall principle is really not that complicated. Just give me a second here. So, let me give you a small example that shows what I mean with undoing things. So let's create a struct. Let's create a type A of type a struct A, and let's give it a constructor which takes some size, and then it also has an integer pointer called memory. And in the constructor, we allocate memory, we allocate an integer array of size variables, of size integers. And so this basically performs the heap allocation, and the pointer to that integer array is stored in the data member mem for memory. That happens in the constructor. And then, because we are smart in the destructor, we implement the destructor to delete that memory such that we don't leak. So whenever we construct a variable of that type, it allocates heap memory. And then if that variable that handles that heap memory goes out of scope, the destructor is being called and the heap memory is freed again. So far, so good. And what we can now do is we can have the following. We can have a try block in which we create some variables A and B. And A and B are of type uppercase A. And here in both cases, the respective constructors would be called. Like here, we call the constructor with a size 2. So an integer array of two integers would be allocated on the heap. And for that variable B, we use the constructor with size 4. So 4 integers would be allocated on the heap. And those pieces of heap memory would then be handled kind of by the variables A and B. And let's say all of a sudden here we really enforce it because we throw anyways. But say at some point you throw an exception because something goes wrong. Then the following happens. So if you now throw an exception here somewhere in the try block, you go back in time. What does it mean? You go, or what your program does basically when being executed then, is if it has an outstanding exception, it goes back line by line, and it, for the variable B, for instance here, it calls the destructor in order to undo what B previously did. And because we have been clever and we implemented the destructors to delete that memory and do the cleanup, if we call the destructor of B, it's like nothing happened because we completely undo what B did in the constructor. So now we go back in time line by line and we hit B and we call its destructor and put B off the stack. We take it off the stack. And then we are in this line here and we see, oh, we have that variable A and the destructor is automatically being called. So the heap memory also gets freed again. And we put that variable A also off the stack. And then we are at the very beginning of the try block. And we then at this point have undone everything that happened so far. And we then see what the exception handler looks like. And here the exception handler catches an exception of type std runtime error, which is exactly what is currently thrown. So this exception handler matches, and this thingy here, this exception handler is then executed. And here we just print gotcha to the command line. That is the principle in brief of stack unwinding. And the good thing is, because we have been clever about things, and right, we deallocated the destructor, we don't have any memory leaks, even though we have some exception. We have some exception handling here. No leaks, or program doesn't leak, which is great, which is really great. So problems when unwinding the stack. We of course also have some problems maybe. So when exception handling fails and the stack cannot be unwound, that might happen at some places if you don't be smart about it, then the terminate function is called, and terminate really leads to a hard program crash. Terminate is called whenever an exception is not caught. So at some point you can only go so far back in time. At some point you are again at the beginning of main, so to say, and if nobody catched or nobody caught the exception, then yeah, no other thing to do, terminate will be called. An exception is thrown while exception handling. So you can, in C++, you can only have one outstanding exception. So if you are currently handling an exception and then another exception is thrown, that's also like you are lost. And there are some more cases which I don't go into detail here. And std terminate calls the terminate handler, and the terminate handler usually leads to a hard program termination. But there's one thing, you can also install your own terminate handler with the function setTerminate. So for instance, we could implement our terminate handler, my handler, and it's just a function, and it does some stuff here. We just print my own terminate handler to the command line and then call abort. And so here we can set our own terminate handler to be my handler. So give it that function as an input. I will show you why that works in a few minutes, so bear with me. And then we throw in runtime error, and then my own terminate handler will be executed, and this will be printed to the command line. And that's really for the worst case scenario. So if you really screwed up completely and terminate will be called, then in the terminate handler, you typically what you do is you save like the most important data of your program. Say you have some very important data, you handle very important stuff, then what you try is you try to save as much as of the important data as possible and store it away for later recovery or something like that. But again, that's really only worst case. So that shouldn't be the standard way to go here. So you can also, talking about exceptions, you can also specify functions as no except. Functions can be specified to be guaranteed not to throw an exception. For example, small and simple functions that do not throw can be marked no except. For instance, here's an add function taking two integer arguments a and b and just returning the sum of a and b. That thing cannot throw an exception, and you can also mark it no except, which is a keyword which you put right after the parameter list to indicate, first of all, to your colleagues, but then also to your compiler, that this function cannot throw an exception. And your colleagues can then see, okay, that thing does not throw, and the compiler also assumes that it does not throw, and then it can sometimes generate faster or more efficient machine code. So first of all, that keyword is about semantics. You can immediately see that this function does not throw, and it is as useful as specifying member functions as const if they don't modify its data members. So it's about semantics and telling people what those functions do, really. May lead to a performance increase. Compilers may generate faster code, but only may. So oftentimes compilers are, of course, smart enough to figure that out on their own. They don't need too much help from your side, typically. Please don't use it blindly, because when people hear, oh, it may generate faster code, then people are, oh, everything has to be fast. I just use no except everywhere. And that's exactly the wrong way to do it. Because if you do it blindly, it may be that the function add does not throw directly, but it may be that some function calls a different function, which in turn throws. And then you have a function which transitively throws an exception. So if you mark it as no except, that would be just wrong. So, and what would happen if you lie to the compiler? What would happen if you mark a function as no except and you still throw an exception in that function? Stud terminate would be called immediately, and it causes a hard program termination here. So please don't lie to the compiler. It doesn't buy you anything. And there was also the idea, as in Java or similar to Java, where you can also annotate your functions to throw, or in Java, it is like if your function throws, you can annotate your function such that you kind of tell the compiler and also other people that it throws. And also that has been introduced in C++, so you can potentially mark or specify functions as throw in order to indicate that they may throw an exception. And then you can even annotate the exception type. For instance, you can annotate with something like that, but that's not really, I mean, first of all, it was a good idea. It was about semantics, and you may then know that what it throws, for instance, and that it throws as in general, but that's really not good practice. So typically, please don't use it. It's not recommended, really. because the compiler cannot check if stood out of range is thrown or something else, and then this becomes pointless if a user of that function only assumes that only this exception that has been specified here can be thrown, but then apparently you throw something else, and then you're basically doomed again because you cannot write the exception handler of corresponding type. That's not very good. The compiler can't check it. So yeah, that was not a good idea as it's turned out. So ignore it. Just for completeness, yeah, I wanted to show that this exists. Anyway, so why should you care about all these specifiers and qualifiers, by the way? Reading code is, of course, not always easy, but if you use specifiers and qualifiers, that typically helps to make your code more readable, because then you better express intent and also not only tell the compiler what you mean, but also your colleagues. So there's a saying that good code should document itself. And code should immediately tell what it does, and otherwise you should probably consider rewriting it. So for instance, you should find useful function names for variables, functions, structs, classes, unions, enums, you name it, all the good stuff. And you might have noticed that when you read a function or function declaration, only the function declaration really, you immediately know what it does. Or at least you should, and if that's not the case, you should maybe consider rewriting it. And also, you should know how it has to be used and how it behaves, but not necessarily how it does its job. So the implementation can be like, that's details that you don't need to know about. For instance, matrix multiply. So it's a function that multiplies two matrices, A and B, and you provide constant references here as parameters. So you can be sure that A and B are not modified within that function, or at least you should. There's very good reason why you should assume that. I don't say you can't write it anyway, but that's a different story. And also, you know that a matrix is returned by values, so probably a matrix will be allocated somewhere in that implementation and will be returned that then contains the result. You have an add function, which receives two integer arguments and returns an integer, so that add function probably adds up those two numbers, A and B, and it does not throw an exception. So you have your vector class vec3, three private double variables x, y, and z, and a public constructor and some other member function, and you pretty much immediately know how this type should be used, which is exactly what we want. So that's just kind of side note. So let's finalize here. Let's finish on exceptions. So what are the pros and cons of exceptions? And I found that in a very good Stack Overflow post discussing the pros and cons. So pros is you have separate error handling code from your normal program flow, right? So you have your program flow, and if something goes wrong, you have your error handling code like separate in the exception handler, which kind of makes it maybe more readable or easier to maintain. Throwing exceptions is the only clean way to report an error in constructors, because constructors don't have return values, so you would not be able to return a value. You could by using an output parameter, but again, that would be kind of terrible, really. At least that's what I feel. So only clean way to report an error in a constructor. It's hard to ignore, because if you ignore it long enough, then your program will just call terminate. It's also easily propagated from deeply nested functions, because it's like automated. It will be automatically propagated until it finds the respective exception handler. Carry much more information than a return code or an error code. And exception objects are matched to the exception handlers using the type system, because yeah, you have matching types there, and the stack is automatically unwound for you, so you have your automated stack unwinding, which kind of undoes everything that happened so far, which is a really cool feature. What are the negative aspects here? So break code structure by creating invisible exit points that make code hard to read. Yeah, that's true. So imagine you have a function which calls some different function, which then calls some library function maybe even, and then that library function throws an exception. You don't necessarily see that that library function throws an exception, so that can be pretty bad as well. So yeah, hard to read because you have those like exit control flow edges which you can't see in the program really. Easily lead to resource leaks when used wrong. Yeah, if you can use it correctly, then it's great here with that automated stack unwinding. But if you use it in a wrong manner, then yeah, you end up having resource leaks, which is the least thing that you want. Learning to write exception-safe code is hard. It requires a bit of practice, of course. Expensive and breaks the paradigm, only pay for what you use. Yeah, that is some kind of it may come with exceptions may come with some cost. So sometimes the compiler cannot generate that efficient code than if you would have used return codes instead. But like for most of the times, it doesn't really matter. And those times that do matter for you, you will probably figure it out, and then you can kind of rewrite your code. I mean, that shouldn't be the reason why you don't use exceptions, but for some projects, apparently it is. Also, if you already have existing code, it's really hard to introduce to existing code, to legacy code, so that's also really hard. And it can also easily be abused for performing tasks that belong to normal program flow. Like, that's typically a thing that the Java guys always do. They use exceptions for like ordinary things to accomplish ordinary tasks, which is not really intended. So it's not good to do that. So when to use what? A rule of thumb I found on Stack Overflow as well. And that can be maybe somewhat helpful for you to decide when to use what. So use assertions to catch your own errors. Make sure you check for pre and post conditions and check your own errors. So check your code that you have influence on, that you wrote yourself maybe even, or that your colleagues wrote. Use assertions for functions and data that are internal to your system. And use exceptions to catch other people's errors, like to check preconditions in public APIs. API is short for application programming interface. So let's say you have some API function which takes some user input, and you don't have any control of that user input. And usually the first thing that you do is you kind of check your user input and check if it's correct. And if not, you would maybe then throw an exception. So use exceptions when dealing with external data that is not under your control. And return codes are basically the poor man's exceptions that can be used here as a rule of thumb. Okay. I previously mentioned that there are some places where you shouldn't throw exceptions. And now I wish to discuss those places here. And the saying really is, you cannot throw in destructors and you should not throw in constructors. That's the saying. You can't throw in destructors and you should not throw in constructors. So why is that? Let me talk you through. So why you cannot throw in destructors? Think of you having a dynamically allocated array of variables of user-defined types. So you have an array on the heap of variables of user-defined types. And let's first assume that you then at some point wish to delete that array of variables of user-defined types using the array delete, right? So what happens if an exception is thrown in the destructor while destructing the second element? That's really, really bad. That's a really, really bad situation. So what happens then if an exception is thrown, for instance, while destructing the second element of that array? Do you wish to abort? If you do that, then you leak all the remaining stuff and you didn't call the destructors, right? So if you just abort, you leak. Yeah, you could also try to just ignore that exception and continue destroying or destructing the remaining variables. And the problem here is C++ can only have one outstanding exception. So if the second element already failed the destruction and an exception is thrown, and then that happens again sometime later, yeah, you are doomed, really. That's also not very good. And you also leak. And the question really is, do you feel lucky? So that's really not a thing to do to a thrown exception in destructors for exactly the reason or situations like those I just described. And you should not throw in constructors. So why is that? What happens if an exception is thrown within the constructor? So you kind of fail halfway, which is also pretty bad, because then you maybe already allocated some memory and you still have some things uninitialized or not correctly initialized at least. So you fail halfway. What can you do? So the variable is not yet set up correctly. So you cannot just call the destructor on it, because it's not, again, it's not constructed correctly. And what you could do is, and that's also really, really a bad thing to do, you would need to do the cleanup yourself. So everything that you already did halfway to the point at which the exception has been thrown, that you must clean up yourself, that mess. And so the problem here is that you cannot use automated stack unwinding, yeah, because it's not fully constructed yet, so you can't just call the destructor. Exactly. So I have to do it yourself. And using a return code is also not possible, so it's a tricky situation. Exactly, tricky situation. So here, be very careful. Be very careful how you do it, how you implement it. Okay. So that would be pretty much all on error handling. So you should at least now, or at least after the homework, the next exercise sheet, you should have a good understanding on how you can handle errors and what would be appropriate in what situation. And there is, of course, no universal truth of when to use what. I mean, you have to decide that on your own using your expert domain knowledge. And you have to decide what to use. Okay, I guess let's leave it there. Then let's revisit pointers one more time. Pointers again. And if you recall pointers, you can have some ordinary value types, an ordinary integer I of value 42, or you initialize it to 42 here in this case. And then you can have a pointer type, a pointer to an integer IPTR, which you initialize and let it store the address of I, and then IPTR points to I. So far we've only seen pointers to variables, but the thing is that you can also have more interesting pointers, and if you paid great attention, you already saw that in the set terminate handler. We already used it there. You can have pointers to functions, because functions are also stored somewhere in your binary, right? So you have the machine instructions of your functions, of course, stored somewhere in your binary, in memory. And that also means that those functions have addresses, right? They are stored in memory, and that memory is addressable, and so you can have function pointers, pointers to functions. How does it look like? It looks a bit weird, but you get used to it. I mean, in C++, many things look weird, of course. It's like sometimes it really feels like a random collection of tokens, just token mess at some point, like a drunk wrote code, and yeah, that's C++ sometimes, right? That would be the syntax here. What would that thing do? What is that? How to read that? That is a function pointer. So f is a variable. F is a variable of type function pointer. And the function pointer f is initialized to the null pointer. So at the beginning, it's just null, points to null. And f is a function pointer that can point to the following functions. F can only point to functions that fulfill this signature here, basically. So the signature is that two integers are passed as parameters. So the function pointer f can only point to functions that accept two integers as parameters and return an integer as a result. So f is a variable of type function pointer to a function of type int, int, int. So two integers as parameters, one integer as a result type. And the variable function pointer variable f can then really point to all functions that match that signature. Yeah, I made that clear already, hopefully. So let's have an example. How could we use that? So we could, for instance, have a function mult for multiplication, which takes two integers a and b and returns just the multiplication of those two integers a and b. And then we can have a function which is called this is not very meaningful or purposeful, but it's just a toy example which proves the point, I hope at least. So then we can have a function which is called perform binary operation, which takes two integers a and b, and it also as a third argument it takes a function pointer f, which must point to functions which receive two arguments as two integer arguments as input and return one argument integer argument as an output. And here in perform binary operation, I mean as the name suggests here, we call that function pointer. And what does it mean we call a function pointer? I mean the function pointer hopefully has been at some point set to a valid function which matches its signature. And then if you call that function pointer, you in essence you call whatever function that function pointer f points to and just feed it with the variables a and b which are passed here. And this will, of course, evaluate to a result, to an integer, which you then return as the result of perform binary operation. So let's have an example. How could that look like? You have your result, a variable for your result. You call the perform binary operation function. You give it two arguments, 4 and 5, which are both integers. And here you use the ampersand, for instance, to get the address of the multiplication function, mult. So and you give it that function pointer. And because that function here matches the signature of that function pointer, like two ints arguments and one int return value, that's perfectly fine. And then perform binary operation will call that function pointer f, which in turn points to mult. So in essence, here the multiplication function will be called. And the result will be like 20, right? 20. That would be one scenario. So why is that useful? We can now pass functions as parameters. We can now pass functions as arguments. And if you recall our integrator program, which integrated a function, that can be used quite effectively. Because we can now have our integrate function, which takes a range from to 2, for which it should do numeric integration. Like that's how we implemented our program at the very beginning, right? And you specify the number of sampling points, n, and then you give it a function, in terms of a function pointer here, that should be evaluated. And then you can have your generic evaluation algorithm integrate, which just generically integrates by using numeric integration the function here that is pointed to by that function pointer argument from to two in that range, basically. That's quite useful, I would say, because you can now write such flexible code here. So we have abstracted away the concrete function. Like in the earlier times, you really had the function to be evaluated written down right here. But now that's not the case anymore. We can now just have a generic function which we parameterize on the function as well by making by giving it a function pointer argument. Exactly. And then we can now integrate everything that matches the signature here of that function. That would be a raw function pointer. There's also a wrapper type for that. I don't have any hard feelings. I mean, you can also use raw function pointers, right? So there's nothing bad about it. You can also use the std function wrapper, which, you might consider fiddling around with raw function pointers a bit tricky. And then you can use the wrapper type, which is in the header file functional. And so you could write it like that. So it's maybe a bit more readable, I have to admit. So as a third argument, you don't give it a raw function pointer, but what you would give it is a std function, something of type std function, a variable of name, also by the name of f, which matches the following signature here. And that would be the same, would have the same meaning here. And please note that when dealing with function pointers and something expects a function pointer, for function pointers, you don't need to do the ampersand. I mean, you can do it, the compiler doesn't care, but for function pointers, if you wish to take the address of a function, you can also just use the name itself, because it doesn't make any sense to dereference a function, kind of. So for function pointers, because nothing else would make sense, you don't need to use the ampersand to get the address of a function. You can also just use that function. It's the same semantics. Personally, I always do the ampersand to kind of denote that I really mean the address. But I mean, you can also do without the ampersand in this situation for function pointers, because nothing else would make sense here. So that would be it for today. Let's recap. What did we discuss today? So why error handling is important, and why our world doesn't crash, which is a good thing, I would say. So we talked about return codes and how to employ return codes to detect errors and propagate errors and then handle accordingly. We talked about assertions, which you can use to detect errors in your own code. We talked about exceptions, which allow you to go back in time and to automatically unwind the stack. We talked about special floating point values, not a number, infinity, negative infinity, and all that good stuff. We talked about functions and templates to check type properties and types in general, which was the type trait setup file, right? Provided that interface. When to use what kind of error handling, at least I gave you hopefully some intuition as a rule of thumb. And at the very end, we talked about function pointers and how those can be used, and also about the wrapper type for that std function. All right, then that would be it for today. Thank you very much, and see you in the exercise classes afternoon. Bye bye.